Well, this subject, I will have to admit, has been a little bit difficult because I felt as though God had laid something deep within my heart, but the ability to bring that out and express it in a way that God has put it on my heart, I've struggled with the words and how to express. Sometimes something can rest in your heart that there aren't really words for. Have you ever had that happen? A deep feeling deep inside that you know is there and is God-given, God-driven. But when people say, what has God been speaking to you? You don't know how to really say what God has been speaking to you. And that's where I am coming from. So I'm asking the Holy Spirit just to take these lips and help me to express what I feel God is trying to say. Our text comes from Numbers chapter 3. And we're going to start with verse 1, but we're really looking at verse 2 through verse 4. But in verse 1, it says, this is the account of the family of Aaron and Moses. At the time the Lord talked with Moses on Mount Sinai. And the names of the sons of Aaron were Nadab, the firstborn, and Abihu, and Eleazar, and Ithamar. Those were the names of Aaron's sons, the anointed priests, who were ordained to serve as priests. Nadab and Abihu, however, fell dead before the Lord when they made an offering with unauthorized fire before him in the desert of Sinai. Now, some of your translations will say strange fire. My translation, I'm reading from the NIV, says unauthorized fire. They were to minister before the Lord, and in doing so, they decided to bring their own fire. Many people believe that where the Bible says, and they fell dead before the Lord, that actually God's fire reached out and consumed them. God literally fought fire with fire. And he consumed them and they died in the presence of the Lord. Now when we look at this, I'm very much aware that in our culture that we have little, unless you study the Bible, unless you study the Old Testament, that most people today, when I say the word priest, you're very, it draws a blank. You don't know what a priest is in the Old Testament. In fact, if you have a Catholic background, maybe what you think of a priest is what you grew up with in the Catholic Church. Or if you read the news today, Catholic priests have a bad rap. And sometimes when we say priest, that's what we think of is Catholic priests that did some bad things while they were serving as a Catholic priest. In fact, when we use the word substitute, again, we draw a blank. The way that we can think of a substitute would be that of a substitute teacher or a sugar substitute. We don't use it, so I forgot what they're like. The pink packets and the yellow packets and the blue packets. And we think of a substitute for something else. And that's what it is. See, the word substitute is a word that means it's to stand in for or it's to be a proxy for somebody else. That's what a substitute was. And a priest was that. The priest was a substitute in the Old Testament or a proxy. The priest stood for God, stood between God and the people. The priest represented God to the children of Israel. And we fast forward all the way to the New Testament, and we find that Jesus has become our high priest. Jesus represents God to us, and Jesus represents us to the Father. He stands in place of, or he becomes a proxy. But before there was ever a priesthood in the Old Testament, before there was ever a priesthood with the children of Israel under Aaron and the tribe of Levi, before God ever instituted that within the nation, there has always been priests from the time that Adam was created. In fact, priests took the form of patriarchs. Now, a patriarch is a family father or the leader of a tribe, and that was a patriarch. God worked for the institution of patriarchs. I believe that patriarchs or fathers are ordained. They're placed by God within family units and within the family as a whole. They're patriarchs. A home without a father or a patriarch is a matriarchal family. That is a family that is led by a woman, and it is a woman-led household or a tribe that is led by a woman. But God has always designed leadership through that of a patriarch or patriarchal society. God has always ordained leadership through that. You'll find that consistent through the Bible. Guys, it is masculine to pray. It is masculine to come to church. It is masculine to kneel before God. That is not feminine, that is masculine. It takes a man to do that. It is masculine to let God touch your heart to where it brings tears to your eyes. That is masculine. There is nothing feminine about it. It takes a man to stand up and to be able to cry before God. It takes a man to say, I can humble myself and I can bow my knee to the Lord Jesus Christ. It takes a man that says, I will fight for my family. I will make sure my family is serving God with everything that is within me. I will not give up on them. I will pray for them every day. The Bible says that Job's children were blessed because Job offered sacrifices every morning for each of his children. And he said, I'm going to do it every day because I don't know what they're doing when I'm not watching them. I don't know if they're serving God, but I'm going to offer a sacrifice every day. That takes a man of God. That takes a true and a real father. But I'm very much aware that women today have had to step up and become the matriarch of their family, of their home, because there's an absence of real men. There's an absence of real fathers. There's an absence of godly men. And my hat and my heart goes out to them because I see what God has done. God has taken the woman, the matriarch, and he has anointed her and he has blessed her. And he has said, I will be a father to your children. I will be your husband. You do what you need to do, and I will work for you because of the absence of real men. And I would rather see a home that is matriarchal than to see a woman with some guy that thinks manhood is all wrapped in how low he can wear his pants and how many tats he has and what kind of a mean look and game face he can put on. Because she is better off becoming a matriarch without a man and doing it with God than dumbing it down to that guy who will mess her up. He ain't even a baller anyway, and he's going to be a lousy husband. So you're better off going alone. I understand all that. But God's order, God's intent, was always to work through a patriarchal system. We've come to an age where men are just absent. Men are gone. Men would rather sit home and watch football than take their kids to church. Men would rather sit at home and do nothing except stare at the TV with the remote while the woman takes her kids and the children to church. And we wonder why there's a breakdown in the family and God isn't touching families the way that he used to do. I believe that God is raising men today. I believe that God is calling men. I believe that God is touching men. And he's calling them to step up and to be a man. I don't want to go off in history, but it's interesting as you look at the church. You know, before the Industrial Revolution, do you know that churches were run by men? Churches were manly. We sang songs back in that day. Well, not we. I don't come from that era. But they sang songs back in that day, the battle hymn of the Republic. How many of you remember those songs? They sang manly songs, Christians off to war songs, and they did all of that. And then the great change in society when men left their farmlands and they came to the inner city and they began to work in factories and they worked 7 days a week, horrendous hours, and they became absent from church. And we go then into the Victorian age, and in the Victorian age, church became the feminine place because men were absent. The songs took on a feminine nature. Jesus, hold me. Jesus, touch me. Jesus, lead me. Lay me in your bosom. Those are all feminine songs. I'm sorry. We sing some today, and it's okay. I've adapted. But they're feminine songs. They're not manly songs. They're feminine songs. And the church became female-led. In fact, the only man in the church was the pastor. The pastor went to the tea parties, and he associated with the women because there were no men. And God then began through different movements, the Azusa Street, revivals like that. God began to pour his spirit out not only on women but on men. And he began to call men again back into a place of leadership and taking their rightful place in the home and with the children. And God began to call them. And then we take a shift again where all of a sudden society is changing again, where our idea of a man is someone who is unmanly and unfatherly, who carries himself like he's something when deep down he has nothing to offer. God is raising up a new generation of men. I see it happening. I see it happening in the spirit. I believe that God is taking men that have been dysfunctional and he's making them functional. He's taking men that have nothing to offer, nothing to give, and he's placing them in his body, and he's empowering them, and he's anointing them, and he's depositing into them, and he's saying, you can be the man that I have called you to be. And God is raising up a mighty heart. Not to displace women and the anointing on women, but to work together with women. One, becoming a mighty army and a mighty unit. So we come to this nation of Israel, and God is going to institute a priesthood. And he chooses through Aaron, he chooses one of the 12 tribes, because there are 12 tribes that make the nation of Israel. And he picks the tribe of Levi, and he says to the tribe of Levi, you are going to be my priest. You are going to stand in proxy between me and this nation that I am calling out. You are our priest. Now, without going into a whole lot of history, this tribe of Levi was unique. They were to teach, they were to pray, they were to offer sacrifices on behalf of the people. And the Levitical priesthood, when they went into the promised land, they were to have no inheritance in the promised land. In fact, if you read Old Testament law, you'll find that they were not allowed to own property. They had no inheritance with the other tribes. The other tribes got all the land and all the possessions from where they conquered, except the tribe of Levi. The tribe of Levi were to give themselves wholly 100% to the Lord, and they were to serve in the temple. Their inheritance, God said, your inheritance, tribe of Levi, is me. It's not what you can get, but it's me. And in that, God instituted the tithe, 10%. That's where the 10%, that's where tithing comes from. It was to support the temple, and it was to support the Levitical priesthood so that they could serve God and serve the people. We have such a problem today with tithing. You see, in the Old Testament, people respected God and they respected the priesthood. We've come to a generation today where people don't respect God. Yes. Oh, we'll come to church, but we don't respect God. Yes. You see, when it comes to giving to God, we throw God a tip. We don't give to God. We just tip him. We Well, it's gone up to 15 to 20% now. And we don't even give God his percentage, but we'll give the waitress or the waiter in the restaurant 20% to carry our... They didn't even cook the meal. They just carried it to our table and stopped by a couple of times and said, would you like a refill on your coffee? But we'll give them more respect than we give the house of God. And we wonder why his house is so lacking. Don't blame me, because it's not my job to make it all happen. It's not my job to make it all happen. And when I go to God and I say, God, you got to do something because we got to pay this bill and we have people working and we're not able to give them anything towards their bills. God, you got to do something. Sometimes I hear God saying, I'm trying, but people aren't listening. Do you know that God can't make you give? We give because we want to. And because we respect God, and we respect his house, and we respect those that labor in his house. And if you can't give with a lot of joy, the Bible says don't even give it at all, because he does not receive it. He doesn't like a reluctant giver. Okay, enough about offerings. John, we'll talk later. Pastor John's going to let me know that I was meddling again. So we come to the sons of Aaron. Nadab and Abihu, they go in to offer into the holiest of holies. And they're allowed to go into the holiest of holies one time a year, one day a year, on the Day of Atonement. And before they're to go into the holiest of holies, they're to go take fire from the altar of incense, and they're to carry that fire into the presence of the Lord. But on this particular day, Nadab and Abihu, they decided to bring their own fire. The Bible calls it a strange fire. It wasn't from God. It was their own fire. And they brought their own fire, the fire they brought by their own design, and they brought that fire to the Lord. Now listen carefully. You cannot offer humanity and carnality to holiness. You can't offer what you create to holiness. God receives that which is of him and that which has come from him. That's what God receives. You cannot muster up anything on your own that pleases God. The Bible says that don't even try, because your righteousness is as filthy rags. You can't produce anything that causes God delight. It's got to come from him, and it's got to come of him, and that is the only thing that he accepts. So the Bible says, give, and it shall be given to you again. Give, and it shall be given to you again. Listen. Why? What you have, God has given. It's come from him. And what you give goes back to him. Are you hearing me? It is not carnal. What you have been given is a gift of Almighty God. It has become holy because his hand has given it to you. And what you give back is holy because it was from him and it's come back to him. It is holy in your giving. Are you hearing me? All right. Leviticus chapter 27 and verse 30. Every tithe of the land, whether it's seed of the land or fruit of the trees, is the Lord's. It is holy to the Lord. You see, you cannot offer that which is carnal to God and please God. It's got to come from God to be able to be given to God. So mark it, whatever you have has come from the hand of God. It was holy being given to you, and when it goes goes back to him, it is wholly being received by him. So when we make a deposit, we are doing something holy before the Lord. So Nadab and Abihu, they come before God and they offer him strange fire. And God starts a firefight. Fire to fire. And he consumes them. And the Bible says that they die. You see, king's business is to be done the king's way. King's business is to be done the king's way. God is particular in what he asks for. He's specific and he's particular in what he asks for. You see, we think our opinions matter. We think that what we think really matters. In fact, that's the problem sometimes in church, is everybody wants to lead the church with their opinion. And God said, I didn't ask you for your opinion. It's my opinion that matters. My church, my opinion, my way. I am king, you are not king. But we think our opinion matters so much that when our opinion is not taken, we get offended and we want to leave. Well, they didn't do it the way I thought they should do it. God never asked you. God doesn't ask me. God is king. And it's his way or the highway. God's kingdom is not a democracy. He doesn't take a vote on how he should do things. He is God Almighty. And he does it his way. And he requires that we do it his way. And when we don't do it his way, we step into a place where we offer strange fire. Well, I'm not going to offer you the fire that you want. I'm going to offer fire by my own design, and I offer strange fire. So let me really simplify it, because we're going to go someplace. The tabernacle was God's. The priesthood was God's. The fire was God. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right, we've established that. To do something other than his order was to offer strange fire. So let me break it down. The Bible says that you are God's. If you have given your heart to the Lord, the Bible says that you have been bought with a price. You are not your own, but you are God's. The tabernacle was God's. You are the new tabernacle. He indwells you by his Holy Spirit. You are as holy as the Old Testament tabernacle. The Old Testament tabernacle was God's. You are God's. When you give your heart and your life to the Lord, you become his possession. You belong to him. You are bought with a price. He paid dearly for you. You are now his. You have now become holy. What you have and your talents and your ability, they are his. Because he gave them to you in the first place. They belong to him. Don't ever think you're something. If you have a great voice, don't for one minute think that you're all that. He created you. He gave you that voice, and ultimately it belongs to him because he can take it in a heartbeat. Don't ever think that your talents and your ability and your gifting and your intellect makes you something before the Lord, because it was him who gave it to you and blessed you with it in the first place. The Bible says that we have become a royal priesthood. The priesthood in the Old Testament was holy. The Levitical tribe was holy. We now become a royal priesthood. We now are holy before the Lord. Psalms chapter 24 and verse 1. The earth is the Lord's, everything in it, the world, and all who live in it belong to God. See, it's got to be his fire. It's not by intellect. It's not by willpower, and it's not by talent. It's got to be by His fire. And anytime we offer something that is not by His fire, by design, it becomes strange fire, and you'll get burnt by it. Oh, Pastor, I don't know if I believe that. Well, everybody told you not to marry that guy. Your mama said, don't marry that guy. The deacon in the church said, oh, no, don't marry that guy. The pastor preached a couple sermons to give direction why you shouldn't marry a guy like that. But you decided to offer your own fire. And when you did, you got burnt. Because you offered a strange fire. You see, instead of doing it God's way, with God's fire, you offered a strange fire. I have met many of people, Christian people, loving God, loving the Lord with all of their life. People that have gone into business with the wrong person and has lost it all. Because everybody, discernment, everybody told them, do not go into business with that individual. But they saw the opportunity, and the opportunity became so great that they decided to offer their own fire. And as a result, they got burned. You see, when you focus on God's fire and God's direction, and you focus on God's way, nothing will ever blow it out, and nothing can stop it. Because if God be for you, who can be against you? When it is God driven and God birthed and God directed, nothing can stop it. All of the demons in hell, if they put their breath together, could not blow that flame out. Because it is God birthed and it is God directed and it is God driven, nothing will diminish it. But when it is not God's fire, you're wasting your time to deal with it. I can't tell you the amount of people that come to me. Oh, Pastor, I feel God called me to do this, and I feel God called me to do that. And oh, I got this burden for this and that. And I say, well, go ahead, let's do it. And as soon as they start, they stop. And I wonder, what happened to them? It's because it wasn't God's fire. It was fire by their own design. And went in, and pretty soon it just went out because it wasn't really lit from God. When God puts a fire in you, nothing can stop it. When God puts a fire in you, you cannot but do what God is asking you to do, because you'll feel like you're going to combust if you don't. Paul said it this way. He said, I cannot but preach the gospel. I can't help but do it, because God has put something in me. And if I don't let it out, I'll burn up, I'll implode on the inside. When God puts a fire in you for something and about something, and God has birthed it in you, nothing will stop it. Naysayers won't stop it. The lack of money won't stop it. The lack of resources won't stop it. The lack of people won't stop it. Nothing will stop it, because it is placed by God inside of you. And it propels you to do what God has asked to do in God's way. I was standing in the back as we were worshiping, and I got a little discouraged. I said, man, there's not a lot of people here today. Not a lot of people. Where did everybody go today? Is it the rain? I don't know what's going on. Not a lot of people here today. And the devil said to me, well, you know what? Grace International, they've got bigger churches that are coming up. Why don't you put in for one of those big churches out in the Houston, Dallas area? Why don't you go out there, the big church, you know, suburban area? They may buy you a new Cadillac. You know, they do that back in the Bible Belt. They treat preachers real well. And so I'm contemplating that, standing in the back. I know I'm confessing I shouldn't do that. I shouldn't be worshiping, right? But I'm contemplating. I'm getting discouraged. And I'm going, God, you know, it's getting really difficult. And then the Lord began to put the fire in me and said, you can either use my fire in my way, or you can go across the United States and offer me a strange fire that I've not asked you to do. Yeah. So I said to the Lord, I said, God, I'll never offer strange fire. I'm only going to deal with your fire, a real fire. So if there were nobody here today but Deborah and my daughter Desiree, because I go get her if she didn't come to church, and my other almost daughter, Erin, and there were three people, they'd be hearing this message. Because fire compels me to do what God has asked me to do in the way that He has asked me to do it.
Yes.
And to vary from that is to offer strange fire. And when you go before the Lord with strange fire, be careful, because you will always be the one to be burnt. I'm going to give you one last thing. It takes divine collaboration. Divine collaboration. You see, some people think all you need is an anointing. Some people pray, God, just show me what to do, show me how to do it, and just anoint me to do it. That's all I want, Lord, is just an anointing. I hear more prayers for anointing than anything else. It's more than an anointing. It's a collaboration, because anointing takes you doing something and beginning to walk it out. You see, when God spoke to Joshua, and He said to Joshua, I'm anointing you to possess the land, but you've got to walk it out. Everywhere that your feet go, every piece of dirt that your feet steps on, everything that you touch, I will give you that land as an inheritance, divine collaboration. It works like this. When God has placed something in your heart, when God has said that I am going to do this in your life, and He ignites it, God's lighting fires right now. You might be sitting here and you have now gotten a fire for your family that you never had before. God birthed a fire in you. He lit the match. And you're going, man, my family, I need to have my family back. And that's a fire now, right now, burning in you. Maybe it's a fire about employment. Maybe it's a fire about a better life. Maybe it's a fire about your relationship to your significant other. Whatever it is, God breathes fire. And when God breathes fire, He gives us the way it's to be done. And to vary from that becomes strange fire, and you'll get burned. But you've got to do something when God breathes fire in you. It now takes action, because the breath of fire, the match lit, is not enough. You've got to start walking it out. You've got to start to do something. And God will show you what to do it. You can't just sit back and say, God, fix it all, make it all better. It takes you collaborating with the fire and the direction of God. So what does that mean? You know, it can be simple, guys. If you're believing God, and God has breathed the fire in you for your marriage, then on your way home out of church, go buy some flowers. Say something nice. Begin to put feet and action to the fire that God has breathed in you, because when you do, things will start to happen. But if all you do is sit back and say, God, just give me a little more fire, that's all you're going to do is you're going to just burn out. You've got to collaborate with God. You've got to put feet, you've got to put action into what God is saying. You've got to get out and you've got to do something. We had somebody stop by this morning, and they said, what do you guys do here all week? What do you do at church? I said, man, I'm not sure you want to know. This is a busy place during the week. I said, we have a live-in program for one. That's not busy all in of itself. We have neighborhood empowerment number two. That is ongoing. We're getting ready. We've been working in Grande Circle. We're moving into Crawley Lane next. We're taking Crawley Lane. That is our next. That is our next neighborhood. If you want to be a part of neighborhood empowerment, come to our meetings. We're doing something. Our motto is less talk, more walk. So Crawley Lane is our next target. We're beginning to form right now the City Compass. City Compass is a navigation center for those that are homeless so that they can come into a one place, one stop, one shop, and be navigated to resources and to places and the help that they can get. And we're creating now City Compass. And we were just given some computers from Jennifer's brother. And one of the computers is being designated to City Compass and another one to Neighborhood Empowerment. And we've got some back there in the cafe that we're loading up for people to job search on. So yeah, that's happening during the summer. And then we do a food distribution on Tuesday nights. And then we make the Panera run on Thursday night so y'all can have some nice, wonderful bread on Sunday morning. We're just busy. But God has breathed the fire. And we're going to start walking it out everywhere we can. We walk out, and as we do, God breathes more fire and more fire, and we just keep walking. But if we sat back and said, no, we can't do that. We can't do that. You don't understand, Pastor. If you do that, people spill coffee all over the carpet. We're cleaning these carpets almost, it seems like, a weekly basis because there's so much traffic and food and meals and everything. And you'll never keep a clean church if you do that. You can't do that. And if we just said, no, we're not going to do it. We're just going to sit back and do nothing. But God, keep anointing us. Keep the fire coming. How many of you know we would burn out? Once the match is lit and you begin to touch some stuff with it, you begin to move in God, the fire begins to grow and God begins to grow a flame around you. I'm going to leave you with this. I have realized in life, I can make it in the Lord as long as I have divine fire. I used to think that I could make it if I had some other stuff. I can make it in God without my car. I can make it in God without my home. I can make it in God without my clothes. God forbid if God ever chose to take Deborah home, it would set me back, but I could still make it in God. But take the fire from me, take that which burns inside of me, take that which drives me, take that away, I'll never make it. Take everything else away, Lord, but don't ever take your fire. Take all the trouble away, but don't ever take your fire. Keep your fire burning in me because that's what directs me. That's what points me in the way. That's what tells me what's next. It's because he's shedding fire over here and then a fire over there and a fire over there that keeps me moving and he keeps me going in his direction because I'm on fire for what he's doing in and through me. I feel bad for people that don't have fire. I feel bad for people that are just sitting and existing, have no direction because God has not been able to light a fire in them. If you're sitting here today and you have absolutely nothing that you're burning for, you need to sit and ask God, light a fire in me, God. Light a fire in me. Light a fire. What are you doing in my life? Ignite a fire so that I can go.
Hallelujah.
I can go for it. mother, you might be here with some children and you're asking God, your fire is, I want a godly man in my life. You keep doing what God has asked you to do. And you keep letting that fire burn. You're not going to find it at the club. Don't go there. That's strange fire. If you have God, I'm going to try to break it out of a strange fire. You see where I'm going? But you keep letting the fire burn and doing what God has asked you to do in the way that God has asked you to do it, and I guarantee you, God will fulfill what you are burning for. God will fulfill what you are on fire for and what you are burning for. God will bring it to pass because it's His fire. And you're walking into the holiest of holies with His fire, and you're doing it His way. And God will honor that. But when you decide to exchange that for something of your own creation, that's when you get burned. Because He rejects it. And in these two priests, He not only rejected the offering, but He rejected them. And He killed them. God, we never reject you because of the blood of Jesus Christ. But He will reject what we offer. He will reject what we offer. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's all stand real quick. We're going to get ready to take our deposit this morning. But before we take our deposit, I'm going to invite you to let God examine your heart. If there is no fire, I'm going to invite you to ask the Lord to light a match inside of you. If you're here today and you know that you've been burnt because you've offered some strange fire, I'm going to ask you to take a minute and just repent and tell God you're sorry. And again, you're going to turn it around and you're going to do it God's way. You are God's. What He has given you is God's. He calls us to give back in His way. It becomes holy. Father, I thank You. I thank You for this portion of Scriptures in Numbers. Not that they offered strange fire, not that they got burned up. But I thank You for the example, Lord, it is to us that You are God. You are the King. You are the King. You are holy. You are awesome. And whatever we do, Lord, in life, we have to be conscious to do it Your way. And a step outside of that is to offer You strange fire that You will reject. Father, I pray that You will help us to focus today. That on those things, those areas that You have lit a match within our life, that we'll be conscious, Lord, to do it Your way. To walk it out in Your way. To be responsible in Your way. To do it the way that You have asked us to do it. And the way that Your Word indicates that it's to be done. Father, if there are those here today that have no fire at all, I pray that You'll begin to light a match in their heart. You'll begin to give them a vision that You'll light a fire in them about something in their life that You are planning and wanting to do, Lord. And we thank You and we give You praise in Jesus' name.